May the words spoken and the words heard be filled with God's Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Very rarely do we hear or read from the book of Jonah. And when we do this morning, we don't hear the really good story about Jonah and the whale. And as much as I would like to preach from Jonah, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to take the risk and speak to you about the call. This is the second Sunday in a row that we hear about such calling that Jesus does. And it's a little disquieting, I think, for us to hear that. I think it's disquieting because this idea of call has become rather separated from our daily lives. We have, in a sense, become trained to look away, trained to ignore it. And there are lots of reasons for that, because if you remember how Moses was called, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, that they leave everything behind, their lives are radically changed. Not always for the better. At least it seems. And today we hear about these four fishermen who are called, and they are immediately drawn away, or so it appears, from their lives. I would love to have known what their father thought about it. We don't hear about that. And you know, I think it kind of puts us off to think that if we are called, we are going to be drawn away from the things that we may value. Family, friends, careers, that for which we have been trained, education. All those things seem to be, well, threatened by the prospect of having to follow Christ. But you know, I'm not so sure. There are other distractions as well. You know, we become involved with our possessions. We become enamored by the power that we amass in life, or the position or status that we may hold. And to look at those in different eyes, other than the ones that affirm them in their own power, can be a little challenging, a little upsetting. Or to use the fisherman's analogy, could really tip the boat for us. So we prefer to kind of bravely run away from the call. Only a Monty Python fan would get that one. Run away, run away. But the truth of the matter is different, I think, for us, because I think we need to take a second look at what's going on in the call that we hear this morning. That in fact, it isn't so daunting. That when Jesus calls those fishermen and they respond, he does something which I think we should pay attention to very carefully. And that is, he tells them, I will make you fishers of people. And this kind of radical call where we become the thing we may fear, and by that I mean very holy, you know, maybe even holier than thou, doesn't seem to be a part of the equation, because Jesus, even though the hymns seem to suggest that we will be somehow magically transformed, Jesus calls them and does something I think is very important. He uses the gifts that they have in the service of God. They keep fishing, in a sense, but in a slightly different context. And I think that's very important for us to know, that when God calls us, I think God isn't somehow zapping us or wanting to zap us into some different kind of existential being. I think what God does is use the gifts that we all have, our individual gifts, to help transform the world in where and of we are, where we are. So it isn't a matter so much of, you know, becoming an ascetic and living in a cave and praising God. You can do that if you want. More likely that your life being opened up to God's love begins to transform that which you find important. And those shifts begin to occur. Those transitions occur to you so that your priorities begin to find another direction. And sometimes it can be as simple as refusing to do some of the things that you held on to. Sometimes it can be as simple as taking up that which is important. I remember a young man whom I knew in a previous parish who was wrestling with the notion of being a stay-at-home dad. Now, at that time, it was not as frequent as it is today. And he faced some real internal pressures about that. That he was going to take time away from work, unpaid, to raise his children while his wife became the breadwinner. And he had all of the traditional sexist approach to this, but somehow he was called to do that. And by opening up to him the possibility that this was a call from God, it helped him see just how important it was. And there are lots of other instances that I can think of where people are where they are and they live that more fully by being who they are and responding to God's presence in their lives. Responding to God's presence in their lives. But there are a lot of impediments. You know, we get attached to things. We find ourselves drawn into areas of this world, and by that I mean things that affect us every day, that are hard to overcome. And yet we still thirst for something. All of us do. We thirst for things all the time. And we feel this kind of tear in our hearts, or a hole, or a yearning, whatever word you want to speak, to address the issue that we're not quite where we want to be. And we respond to it in a number of manners, a number of ways. You know, you think of how some people find that possessions can become their distraction in life, keeping them busy and so on. I know of someone who bought a lovely boat, convinced as she was that sailing the Atlantic would distract her from her woes. She bought the boat, beautiful boat. Anyone ever been to Gloucester in Massachusetts? She bought the boat, beautiful boat. Did that for several years. But that too kept the yearning only at bay. Only at bay. Then, like a lot of other people who live the big life, another distraction came along. Decided that perhaps buying a cottage in New Hampshire on a lake would help her to get away from it all. You know? That cottage would be a place of refuge and find the kind of peace that she could not find in her life. Now, that too lasted for a while, as a lot of these things do. So another friend told her, why don't you do what I did, which was fly around the world for a year, take away time off from your job for a year and fly around and have a good look at the world. Get a better perspective on life, you know. But no matter what happened on that year, flying around, visiting all these exotic places and seeing these different strange cultures, same thing was left. There was a tear in her life that no matter what she did, found its way back to her. And that tear became, well, a problem for her. So she spoke to someone who said, why don't you come to the My Faith community and we'll all look at that tear. And maybe when you come there, you'll find that that tear has something for you that you never saw before. But in that hole, something will come and fill it. That there's a calling there for you. And that calling is something whose fulfillment does not end and stays with you all your life. The call of Jesus Christ to be who you are, where you are, and to love Him as God has gifted you to love him. Amen.